Feliz Navidad, próspero año y felicidad.
Hello everyone, happy holidays. It is December 21 and it is the very first day of our 10 days of Tiny Disc. So what we're going to do is we're going to be dropping a new short episode each day leading up to December 30th, leading up to the end of the year. And each episode is going to focus on one award, one kind of topic that we're going to talk about, where we're going to bring all these games together and just have a good time. We're going to award some Tiny Disc awards to games, and it's going to be a great way to cap this crazy, crazy end of the year. I'm Robert Scarponito, joined here by Jack Cepeda.
Bong bong. This is an international affair. I want to thank you gentlemen for flying here halfway across the world to this French villa. We're having a lovely brunch now, and this is for you people. And, you know, the food is good. The coffee's good. Never been to France before.
Same.
This is going to be an experience, but we came here just for Game of the Year discussions, and what a day this is going to be. The first annual 10 Days of Tiny Disc. Bong, bong.
And we also flew in Colin Sparling. How's your baguette, Colin?
It's great. You know, I'm chowing down on some frog legs, some snails. It smells really bad here. I don't know.
Fuzzy
but
pickles.
I'm having a good time. You just got to kind of plug your nose a little bit with the snails.
Yeah, I'm enjoying my escargot marinated in French red wine. I think that's a thing. I'm not sure that's a thing.
Y'all fuckers don't know how to brunch.
You said French. I'm rolling off that.
All right. Okay.
Yo, frog legs taste like chicken and fish. It's the weirdest thing.
Have you ever done a chicken's foot?
I have.
No, I haven't.
See, it seems like it's the ratio of meat to bone in a chicken's foot seems askew to me.
Yeah, it's not.
Can you
really
confirm?
It's not worth it. It's one of those things where it's like waste not want, not, you know, that to me that's kind of what chicken feet are.
I couldn't. I just give me the wing, man. Give me the breast, give me the thigh.
Mhm.
Okay, so let's get to Game of the Year.
Yeah.
Discussions.
We're not going to talk about Game of the Year today. That's what we're saving for near the end. But today,
games of this year.
Yeah. Today what we decided to do, because a recurring theme is, man, I wish I played that game. Man, there's so many good games coming out. Holy crap, every week. So, for this episode, we're going to talk about the games we most wish we played from 2017. So, does anyone have anything they want to throw out right at the get-go here?
Oh, man. Top of the list, Nier Automata, for sure. I know you guys have already gotten to play it, but it's one of my biggest regrets. And it's one of those things where I'm just kind of like waiting to have the money, and I just want to throw my money at who produced it, who published it,
Squeenix
it?
Published Platinum. Right,
yeah. Is it Platinum that made it, right?
Mm-hmm.
yeah that's right. But yeah, like I want to give them my money so bad right now. I've just been between making time for other games and school and a whole bunch of other life stuff, I just haven't gotten around to it. And the gameplay, I already know from playing the demo, is amazing. I know from what you guys tell me it's amazing. I know from other friends it's amazing. And just the crazy amount of genres the game covers, the characters, the ridiculous amount of fan art across the internet these characters. And, like, I don't know, there's just a whole, like, this is one of those games where, like, I never ever thought, like, a game like this was going to happen, because Nier just wasn't, kind of went out with a whimper, wasn't really a big game. It picked up steam a couple years later. It came out as, like, a hidden gem for the PS3. But then they announced, you know, Nier Automata was going to be a thing. And I was like, holy shit. And it actually looks amazing. So, yeah, I definitely need to get around to playing that before the end of my Christmas break.
You're starting with the banger here, man. You're pulling out the big guns. Start out. Yeah. So this is a game that came out, what, around the March-ish time, the April-ish time?
Mid-March, I remember. Came out.
Yeah,
at least for
that's why, because it was Zelda time. It was Zelda time. That's why I didn't play it.
It came out for consoles first, and then like a couple days later, it came out on Steam.
During this 10 days of Tiny Disc, this game is going to get a lot of attention, I can already tell. Because, you know, Robert, you and I, we played it already, but Colin, man, like, dude, it's one of the best games of the year.
I know.
Let it slip through the cracks. Don't let it be the one that got away. Like, there might be a sale going on, right, on Steam, maybe around Christmas time, so who knows, but keep an eye out, because, you know, like I said, I'm going to save my opinions on it, you know, for later, but for sure. What other games do you have that, you know, you kind of wish you spent more time on? I know there's a bunch, because, like, we're, at least for me, I can speak, like, I'm definitely time poor, right? Because working full time and everything, and getting married this year. Like, it was a huge year. This was an awesome year for me, actually. Like, moving to Austin.
Crazy year here. For in all aspects for you, man.
Yeah,
for
sure. I know. It's just been whirlwind. And then, you know, starting this podcast, like, we've been doing this, like, what, about 6 months now or so? Like, it's getting around there. Like, this is the, you know, but this is a cool thing, and I'm glad to be in it with you guys. It's going to be experience. There are definitely some games that slipped through the cracks for me. One of the ones that really come to mind is Prey. I know that was getting a lot of attention. That supposedly had a really good story, had a really interesting battle mechanic. And so I did play the demo. And the demo's, you know, kind of short, but it does set the stage. And it's doing some interesting things. It has a really unique intro as well. I won't spoil for anyone. That you just go in and go into Steam and just download the demo for free and check it out. But there was too many, right? There was just too many great games this year. It's a great problem to have. And that's one of the games, unfortunately, that slipped through the cracks. But if I had infinite time, I would absolutely buy Prey, and I would absolutely play it. And I think I would enjoy it based on the demo.
See, my worry with Prey is when I first saw it, right, when it first came out, it was like, oh, man, that actually does look really cool. But now looking at it in retrospect, I can't decide, like, if the hype around it was because it's a good game or because that was one of the rare times this year where there was kind of a lull where there were no other good games coming out. You know what I mean?
Yes, and this is also supposedly, I mean, it was touted as the rebirth of the infamous Prey 2 E3 demo from, like, what, like 2011 or something like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, yeah. Actually, I think if my copy of Fallout New Vegas, I think, has an ad for it. Like, Prey 2. Yeah.
They did have those going. And then, dude, the infamous E3 demo. Go on YouTube and watch the, like, 20-minute demo of Prey 2 that never got released. And you're just like, holy shit, why can't games be like this? This is absolutely incredible.
Oh, I remember, actually. I remember, like, it was supposed to be this huge open world thing. And, everybody was shitting themselves over it. Yeah.
It was incredible. I watched it, and I was, like, slackjaw the whole time. Like, wow. So then when they remade this Prey, they're like, oh, this is going to be that. And what I played in the demo was not that at all. I don't know.
It didn't look like that.
I can't comment on whether it gets there. It doesn't seem like it's going to get there. It doesn't even seem like it's going there based on the way the demo ends. But, you know, man, I would just say, like, guys, go watch that old Prey 2 E3 demo. It is, like, amazing. And it's aged incredibly well. It's still, like, considered among modern games being released now, still being considered, like, one of the coolest things I've seen in interactive media. Seriously, like, it's that good.
Yeah,
dude, it's almost like the video game version of the death of Superman.
Huh.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think so. Wow,
the whole Nick Cage Superman thing that was supposed to happen.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I don't know. For me, like, one of the titles I really wanted to play is Assassin's Creed Origins, which came out, like, on the same day as Wolfenstein 2 and Odyssey, right? And I keep hearing that it's better than, like, most other Assassin's Creeds. And I'm like, I want to believe, but I can't believe it till I actually play it, you know? So, like, part of the reason I didn't play it was also that I don't know if a $50 ticket is the right price to see whether I believe again.
Right.
But I don't know. I hear good things. I hear that the story's all right. I hear the world is beautiful. You know, it's like a great recreation of ancient Egypt, one of the coolest times in ancient history, right?
Yeah, and it's a setting that hasn't really been explored all that much in video games, to be honest with you.
Absolutely.
At least set, like, directly in the time period during the ancient Egypt. Because, I don't know, I mean, I think it's more so, like, on the basis of trying to come up with good ideas gameplay-wise for that type of setting, and I think that's why it hasn't really been done all that much until now. And Assassin's Creed Origins did look appealing to me, and I'm actually one of those people that I played a lot of Assassin's Creed. Like, I was one of those people that, like, every year for years, I would get the new Assassin's Creed game for Christmas, and I would beat it over Christmas break. That was, like, my thing.
Wow.
I would sit there and play it for hours on end to the point where my dad would be like, hey, you gonna, like, actually do something today?
There's a lot of people that, like, every year, they're like, oh, shit, Assassin's Creed this year, let's do it. Like, there's a lot of people that have been very loyal to the franchise through like some really low lows, in my opinion.
Right. And that's what I'm saying. I just, after about Assassin's Creed Black Flag, I didn't even beat that one. And I played it for a little while. I was like, hey, ship combat's pretty cool. And then I was like, yeah, but I'm kind of done. I'm good.
See, Black Flag to me is one of the high points. And I think they were given away for free recently as well, if I remember.
Yeah, and I'm not saying it's a bad game. I think I was just burnt out on the whole like assassinating mechanic, like, hey, go kill this dude, go kill that dude. And the fact, I think the biggest thing, I don't want to spoil anything. Is it okay if I spoil the end of Assassin's Creed 3?
Three, sure. I don't care.
So I know. Listen,
spoilers
after
Assassin's Creed 3, everybody.
Yeah, spoiler alert. Desmond dies, and that's what kind of killed a lot of the story for me.
Because they killed the protagonist.
So. Yeah, because I was like, because I think it has to do with the turmoil that was going on at Ubisoft at the time, how they got rid of their writers and got new ones. And they killed off Desmond, and like the fucked up thing was they don't even really tell you, because it's not one of those things that says like the end of Assassin's Creed 3, it's not clear that he's fucking dead, you know what I mean? They kind of like they play it off like he is, and then Assassin's Creed 4 they're like, oh yeah, he's definitely like 100% dead, like here's a video of his corpse like being observed. Yeah. Sure.
What I hate is that they're trying to keep that real world story part of Assassin's Creed alive despite Desmond's death, and it's like, guys, just stop. Like, we're here to play in our history playgrounds. That's all.
I was gonna say they even had the nerve to dick tease us with the modern day setting in Assassin's Creed 3, where you got to like skydive into onto the skyscraper, and Assassin's Creed 3 is Desmond.
Yeah.
I was like, yo, why can't this just be the game? Like,
you got honey dicked,
awesome.
Dude.
They honey dicked you. I was so sad.
I was gonna say that Assassin's Creed Origins.
I think it's
an S.
Okay, is one of the most demanding graphical games, graphically wise, that I can play. I have to like limit my FPS to like 60, which is rare, but it, because I want the draw distance to be really detailed, so that will like crush any like GPU, right? So it's a great looking game, I can say that. Fucking boring as all hell in the beginning, and I just couldn't get over
that's
the
what
hump.
I heard.
Yeah, and it is, though, I will say, it is the most high profile game that I did not buy this year that I would buy for like $35 probably. As I'm waiting, but I don't care enough to like spend full price on it, or even $50 on it. You know, I hate to put like a price tag on like, you know, on these kind of things, but it's just, it's, I don't know, it's not selling me. It's not doing. I will say, though, it appears that they are benefiting from taking a year off of the series.
Oh, yeah.
And it seems to be the better for that. So if I had infinite time again, this would be one of those games I would play as well. But I'm gonna wait till it goes on like half price sale.
Yeah, and to close the Assassin's Creed discussion, the game looks cool. I like the setting and things like that, and I've actually heard that the combat plays a little bit like The Witcher. I don't know how true that is.
I've heard that. I wasn't getting that, but again, I only played a few hours.
Okay. But I think the only thing that kind of like kills it a little bit for me is it kind of just has a lot of elements of just modern Ubisoft games in it. Like, you know what I mean?
Map quest markers everywhere.
Yeah, and they're
quests.
Like they literally just took the drone from Assassin's Creed from Ghost Recon Wildlands and reskinned it as an eagle in Assassin's Creed Origins. I was like,
you know, old drones.
Yeah. Lest you forget, this is an Ubisoft game, straight up. Like, don't worry,
dude.
we got your markers, we got your objective.
Yeah,
we got your
towers. They just took the world from Ghost Recon, they reskinned it to look like Egypt.
They've added some
just
pyramids.
Like they did with Far Cry Primal, the same thing that they did with that.
I also made the mistake of watching the Donkey video on the game, and there's like major story spoilers in it. So I was like, oh, okay. So I don't know.
I heard the story's good
all?
After the first 5 hours. So who knows?
Oh, that's all.
Yeah,
okay.
That's all. Just 5 hours of your time.
Yeah.
But, do you guys have any other games that you wish you played this year?
Oh,
I have a bunch.
Yeah. Let's pick another.
Let me rattle off a few here that I don't want to talk too in depth about. Okay. Golf Story on Nintendo Switch.
Oh shit! I didn't put that on my list. I forgot about that one.
Absolutely a worthy game. I spent a few hours, 4 or 5 hours, maybe even 6. I didn't beat the game. It's much longer than I thought it would be. It's very good value, I think, and I think that game's a standout. It's unique. It's one of the best games on the Switch, in my opinion, that was released this year. So there's nothing like it. I mean, go check it out. Also, Little Nightmares. Little Nightmares, guys. little nightmares.
Little nightmares.
Have you seen anything on this game?
I've seen the design.
Yeah,
of it.
I'm pretty sold on it though.
Oh,
like I do want to play it at some point.
Dude, it is. Yeah, I want to get on that, and it's not that long either. It's about 3 hours long. So look out for that one. I think that game. I don't know. I don't hear anyone talking about it, and it's like the closest you could ever get to playing a Tool video. You know what I mean? It totally is, dude.
Yeah. Is it really that abstract though?
It's fucked up. Yes, I've seen a lot of it. Dude, it's fucked. Like, well, I'll show you some later, but Little Nightmares, like, I could see people forgetting about this year, but man, I think it's a cool experience. And it's definitely high tension. It's definitely kind of terrifying and very disturbing.
I think that's how Death Stranding happened, was like Hideo Kojima was watching a bunch of Tool videos, is like, holy shit, this is cool, I'm gonna do something like this,
while injecting all the heroin, coke, and meth directly into his eyes.
If you're bringing up Death Stranding, I think it's basically the sequel to Yoshi's Island, where you're escorting the baby. So
there you go.
Drop the baby, starts crying. There'll be a Yoshi Koopas in there, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah, Mads Mikkelsen plays Yoshi.
So another one real quick, I don't want to talk about too long. South Park, The Fractured But Whole. I totally went, you know, skipped over it, not because of anything other than I don't have enough time, right? And I don't have the resources to put into it, but I would totally spend time in that game. The Stick of Truth was, I think, like, so good and such a awesome technical like feat they did to make it look like you're playing the damn show.
Yeah, to me it's a feat in that I think it's one of the few licensed games I can think of that stays the truest it could possibly be to its original source material.
Yeah. I have on my list, I have like three more. Do you just want me to rattle them off real
quick? Sure. Yep.
Okay. Night in the Woods. I keep hearing some good critical buzz about this game. Same. Again, this is a game that I'm like, fuck man, there's so many games coming out this year, I only have so much time. You know, I couldn't dedicate the time to that. I couldn't pull the trigger. But again, over break, if there's a decent sale on it, I would pick it up and I would play it, because I just keep hearing things over and over and over about how good that game is. Let's see, Absolver, same kind of thing. Like, totally went under my radar. Apparently,
yeah, that one's on my list too. Yep.
Yeah. Apparently, they had some hiccups in the beginning. They, you know, didn't put out maybe the most polished finished product at all. But they have done some updates to it. And apparently they also did a free weekend recently, and the community's kind of picking up. But that game really depends on people playing online. And if the community disappears, there aren't people online to fight, then there isn't really much of a game going on there after you get past the single player, which what I hear is somewhat limited. However, like, among one of the deepest combat systems, you know, in a long time in a single player game. So kind of interesting.
Yeah, it's a fighting game version of Dark Souls, essentially.
Yeah.
Right, right.
That's why I'm a little surprised, Jack, that it's on your list. Because again, it's a Dark
Souls
game.
It's a fighting game. Here's the thing, though. Like, okay, I'll say it again. I don't think you guys are like understanding me with Dark Souls. Dark Souls combat is very shallow to me. It's two attacks. There's a bunch of weapons and stuff, but there's two attacks, and you circle around and poke people in the butt all day. Like, okay, I get it. But like, Absolver is very deep combat, right? Very deep, very stance driven, and that's why I like Neo too, because it's very deep combat. Like, those are the things I enjoy about these kind of games. Not necessarily the Souls aspect of it. That's fine. I can cope. But it's the combat is which bring me to it, which is why Dark Souls is just like, oh, just die. Like, Dark Souls to me kind of seems like a Final Fight game. Do you remember those beat 'em ups where you just like punch and kick and jump, like Streets of Rage kind of shit?
You're wrong, but okay.
Okay, maybe I am wrong, you know, but that's why I'm drawn to Absolver and Neo. So, all right, my last game that I really wish I played this year. Fucking, this hurts me so bad in so many different ways. Battlefront 2.
No.
Star Wars.
What?
Yes. I wish I played that. I wish I could play that game. I'll put it that way.
You can in good conscience.
Yes. I wish I could dedicate time and money to that game. But the way it was released, like, I cannot justify buying that game. I cannot justify putting money into it to try and, like, level up. Like, no matter all the changes they're trying to make, they haven't made good. They've really sullied Star Wars as far as video games are concerned. The name, the brand, it's just really sad. I'm, like, really, like, lamenting the fact. Because you guys know I was looking forward to that game. Like, I was legitimately looking forward to that game. I was hype on it. I was like, I'm ready for episode one shit. I'm ready for all this awesome Star Wars. Give it to me. And then, obviously, you know, we talked about it ad nauseum on this podcast. But for obvious reasons, the loot box debacle, everything, the way EA is addressing it, I couldn't play it. And so I wish that game was good. But
yeah, and that's the thing. Oh, I was gonna say, sorry, Robert. I would just like to say, like, I know there's been a lot of negativity surrounding, you know, this game and a lot of practices that EA has been doing. But the thing is, like, at the end of the day, like, we don't want, you know, even if it is EA and, you know, we have some sort of vendetta because of the practices that they've had in the past, like, we don't want them to put out a game and have it fail. Like, we want games to come out and be good, and, you know, we want to be able to praise a game. You know, we're not, it's not like, I mean, okay, maybe some gamers do, but I don't, we don't look for negativity. You know what I mean? We're not, like, looking for a game to shit on. We don't want to shit on a game. Like, I was really hoping that Battlefront 2 was going to be a huge improvement and that it was going to be good.
Yeah.
You know?
And then microtransactions happen. But my question, right, Jack, is, like, so this is on your list of, like, games you really want to play. What is it about the game that, like, was, you know, yeah, I want to play this?
I want to be immersed in that world, you know? I think that, right, that Destiny 2 has the feel and the technical chops, but I don't care about the world at all. And Star Wars, I think, like, isn't the best shooter, but the atmosphere, the music, the graphics, the locations, the execution overall on a technical level is there for me. But I just can't sit there and, you know, and get killed by people and shown, like, oh, they bought this and this and this, and that's why they killed you, and this is why you can't get any kills in this game, because all these people spent money. Don't you want to spend money? It just makes me feel bad. Like,
yeah.
Like, right. I hate to sound like such a bitch about it, but I don't feel good playing this game. It just makes me feel like, aw.
You know, I want to
like it. Right. I'm a big Star Wars fan. You know, I worked at a movie theater when Episode 1 came out, and I saw, like, the fandom, like, come in, you know, and I was, you know, and I love the original trilogy. I'm just a big Star Wars fan, so I hate seeing what could have been, right? I just can't help but thinking about what could have been with this game, and so that's why it's, like, so disappointing, and why I wish I actually spent, you know, I wish this was a big shooter to play this year,
right? And I think that and it really sucks, because a big reason, you know, I mean, the obvious reason why people wanted to play it is because it's Star Wars. Like, when it comes to licensed games, the big reason why people buy licensed games is because they want to dive into that world. They want to put themselves in the driver's seat within that world and just immerse themselves and forget about everything else. And, I mean, even though the actual gameplay itself may not be good, and that's the case with a lot of licensed games, like, you take away, I don't know, Naruto, like a Naruto game or something, right? You take away the Naruto license from, like, some of the Ninja Storm games, they're kind of not that great of fighting games. Like, they're not bad. They're competent fighting games, but they're not, like, over the top, like, 10 out of 10 fight. They're no, like, Guilty Gear or, like, Street Fighter. You know what I mean?
They're like 5 out of 10 fighting games, but okay.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, that's what I'm getting at. Like, so the fact that, you know, something goes as far as, like, overshadowing something like Star Wars, you know, something bad happened, right?
Yeah.
So
for sure.
It's just, you know.
Right, because they have all that cachet, that brand, like, you know, recognition, all that strength to go on. Like, how do you not slam dunk this game?
Exactly. Like, it's basically built to print money with or without their microtransactions. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. You let greed get in the way, and then you just address it all wrong. That's how I guess. Right. So
forked
yeah.
it up.
So, but Robert, like, what are some on your list?
Can I bring you guys all the way back to January? Can I bring us back 12 months?
Yeah. By the way, let me ask real quick. Are you guys going to eat any more of that bread? Because I'm going to eat that.
I might eat a little bit more. Do we have olive oil? Do we have any extra?
About to ask, dude.
We'll just get
you
more.
Better
we'll
leave
just
some
more.
Olive oil.
All right, don't worry. Waiter? I'll eat this and we'll get more.
Waiter? Thank you. Okay.
This bread is too hard.
All right. Monsieur.
Monsieur. Monsieur.
Garçon.
Okay. Garçon. That's a waiter. That's not a waitress.
Resident Evil 7. You guys remember that?
Yeah, that's actually on my list. Resi 7, man.
Yeah, I kind of forgot, like, wow, that was 2017, man. Mm-hmm. I remember first seeing that, and I was like, yo, this looks really good. And, like, second half of last year, they were doing that thing where, like, they released that demo, and they kept updating the demo with extra little details, and it was, like, this huge conspiracy of everyone online trying to, like, piece together, like, what does this mean? What does that mean? What does this mannequin finger fucking
do?
Yeah,
what does this dummy... What the fuck does this dummy finger do?
Yeah. And I played through that demo, like, quite a few times, and I'm just like, wow, it's so cool. So I really wanted to see what it was like to play the game, like, the actual for real game, which I've heard is very good, and it's like a return to form for what Resident Evil kind of should be. You know, this isn't Call of Duty Resident Evil 6. This is a true Resident Evil game. And I think the only reason I didn't really pick it up is just, like, at the time I didn't have the money for it, and now it's just like, yeah, I could spend $30 on a sale to play it, or I could catch up on other games, you know?
Right.
Which is unfortunate.
No, I feel you. Like, Resident Evil 7 definitely, like, appealed to me. The whole demo thing that, I mean, I think it's fair to say that, like, that was Capcom being opportunistic and capitalizing on what PT brought to the table.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it would 100%, and it was a completely smart strategy. They're like, holy shit, Konami's not going to follow through with the Silent Hills thing? Fuck, we got to, like, we're jumping on this train. Like,
seriously, yeah, they filled a gap, man. There was definitely a lack in, like, great horror games, I think, for a while there, you know, especially with that Konami fallout, for sure.
And I think that's the thing that with like a big reason why I haven't picked Resi 7 yet is because like, do I really want to pay $30 to shit my pants?
Guys, I mean, we're talking about probably the quintessential like VR experience as well. Like, I know you're probably planning on playing it like normal, right? Quote unquote. If I were going to play the game, I would play it on PSVR. But I'm just like, seriously, like I've talked about it. Like, I don't want to be alone in my house.
Yeah, like when Jack, I'm playing it. If you play the VR version of it, you know you're going to have to sit on the toilet. Like, you're just ready. You have to be ready to go. Right?
That is the one game. When people come over and they want to try VR, I give them that game. I throw them right into the deep end. I'm like, fuck you. You're going to hate VR from now on. Jeez. We're going to do this. And that's the first thing I let them play before even any driving or any like duck simulators or whatever the hell, swimming with dolphins.
You heard it here first, folks. Don't go to Jack's house. He'll torture you.
I will torture you, and I'll take you to all the scariest places in that game too. But it's so fun to watch. It really is entertaining to watch other people do it. Suffer.
yeah, another game that I really wanted to hit up, actually, is Final Fantasy XIV in general, but especially because that expansion that came out this year that like really made the game worth it, Stormblood. I've heard that expansion basically is a true Final Fantasy title just in the MMO. So it's like the story is at a high caliber and just like all the beats for it are really good. And I've kind of like, I played through the trial earlier this year and I was like, wow, this actually isn't bad for an MMO. So I've kind of been like towing the line between like, do I want to invest in a subscription MMO in year of our Lord 2017?
Wow.
You know?
So you pay the full price and then it's like additional monthly.
Yeah, and here's the really tough thing. Over Black Friday sale, they were like, yeah, we'll give you the whole game with all the expansions for $25.
Oh.
And then $13 every month after that.
Right.
And
so,
it's like, ugh.
So they are doing a free trial, isn't it? Like up to level 15 or level 30?
Level 35 for all the jobs. So you could play for a long... Yeah, it's pretty big, but it gets to a point where, like, let's say you stick with one job. And then you do all the quests you need to do or you can do to get to 35. It's not like you can farm those quests again. So to get the other jobs to 35, you're basically just farming monsters, you know, for like a long time.
Right. Just to play devil's advocate as well, if you need like that MMO bugs itch scratched, they do have Elder Scrolls Online. Like it's pretty cheap and it's just like a one-time buy and there's no monthly.
Yeah, it's true.
Just know that. And I hear good things about that game too. And I did buy it, but I haven't played it yet.
Nice. Hey,
can you not do like WoW does and buy subscription time with in-game currency? Because WoW does that.
Yeah, there's no like subscription charge in Elder Scrolls Online. They just don't even do it.
Yeah. So. Oh, I was talking about Final Fantasy.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't looked that up for sure.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I would be interested in that game. I hear good things about that as well. And they let you ride around, I think, if I'm not mistaken, in the Magitek armor from Final Fantasy VI, Colin.
I think so.
That's a mount, dude. Isn't that a cool ass? And that's, I think, dope. There's mogs there too. Like, yes.
Yeah.
Give me, please.
All right.
They're definitely leaning on their heritage.
Colin, do you wanna spout some truth about what you wanted to play this year?
Spit some game, son.
Yeah, so I'm just gonna rattle some off, then I'll hit a bigger one. So more Horizon because I haven't played enough yet. Wolfenstein 2 because I hear you guys talk about it all the time and it kills me that I don't know much about that game yet. Because I still need to play the first one and the Old Blood.
Yeah, I didn't play the Old Blood and I still get it if that helps you. Old Blood's more of a like spin-off side story.
Yeah, and I also heard it takes you back to the 40s, which is cool. Cuphead, of course.
Yes.
Uncharted Lost Legacy.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Yeah, definitely need to play that. I'm a huge Uncharted fan. I'm just waiting for it to get cheap because it's going to get dirt cheap at some point.
I'm an Uncharted fan, but is Nathan Drake in it or not? You play as the chick the whole time, right?
No, he plays Chloe.
See, I don't know Uncharted if I could do that. I don't know.
I mean, I'm into it. I like Chloe as a character. And you get to team up with Nadine, and I thought she was a really interesting character in 4.
Yeah, I can agree with that. And Chloe is pretty cool.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Evil Within 2, I really enjoyed the first game. It didn't actually beat the first game, but what I played of it, it was cool to see a new game from the original creator of Resident Evil, whose name escapes me at the moment. Mario plus Rabbids. Definitely want to pick that. Yeah, definitely really want to play that one.
It's fun.
Rime, which I heard runs like garbage on Nintendo Switches, which is why I was waiting to play it, because I wanted to play the Switch version, but it runs like garbage on there, apparently. So I'm just going to get the PS4 version, I guess. Tacoma, even though it's just basically gone home in space. And the biggest one for me is more Persona 5.
Yeah,
that game is, it's a big ask, man. I mean, there's no doubt it's a quality game. You know, so many RPG of the Year awards lauded towards Persona 5, but that's a big one on my list too. Like, man, I just wish I had the 100 hours to finish the game. I did play, like, you got to play like over 10, 12 hours to beat the first kind of quote unquote dungeon. It's a heavy ass game. If that's one, that's if you're going to play one game, one RPG this year, that's the one to play.
Absolutely.
You know, I definitely would recommend it. It's just same for me though. I just wish I had more time in it. That's all I can say. I mean,
yeah, that's pretty much more. Yeah,
it'll come up more like during you know our talks here in the coming days. But it's a great game. It's such a shame I didn't have the time.
Man, they should have just came out with a Vita version.
Can I just say, as someone who has put 97 hours and then like 20 or so more for New Game Plus, it's so worth it. It's so good. Like, I wish I could talk to you guys.
Yeah.
About just everything that happens after the second dungeon.
The second one. So like about 20 hours in.
I mean, at least. Things get crazy. Things like there's twists on twists. There's like if M. Night Shyamalan was in this but actually did good, you know, storytelling.
M. Night Shyamalan, a ding dong.
Yeah. Like, there's so much in this game that kind of keeps you excited. Even 60 hours in, like, seriously, 60 hours in, I remember that was a point where I was like, are they doing shit? They're doing something like this one.
Oh,
it's
wow.
So cool. It's so great.
There's no excuse. It's not on the Vita, man. And I did play it on Vita with remote play.
I did it
that way, but not a great experience for me. And why isn't there? There's a PS3 version. There needs to be a Vita version. I would play more of it if there was a Vita version. That Persona 4 is so good on Vita.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think they're going to come out with it on Vita. I'm waiting for a Switch version. I think they're going to do a Switch version at some point because they already have Shin Megami Tensei 5 coming out on Switch.
I'm not sure about that, though, because Shin Megami Tensei has historically been on Nintendo consoles, whereas Persona has historically only been on PlayStation consoles. Yeah.
I wonder. I mean, it'd be interesting to see. I mean, but then again, a lot of games that have not historically been on Nintendo are coming to Switch, to be
fair. That's true.
So we'll see.
Yo, I would buy it full price again if it came out on Switch. Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. And it would just make it so much easier to, like, you know, get through a dungeon if I have time to play on the go or whatever I'm doing. It'd be nice just to have it portable.
I'd spend another $60. I'd lick that cartridge, slap it in my Switch, and never take it out.
I'd hate... That was kind of hot sounding. I hate having to rebuy, like, new games, man. I'm thinking about, all right, I'm going to buy Zelda on the Switch. You know, I'm going to buy... Now they got the Dragon Crown PlayStation Pro version out. I'm like, oh, shit, do I have to rebuy that fucking game now? So, real quick, guys, two other games I didn't bring up, but totally neat or, like, kind of unsung, under-the-radar indie games, Dead Cells and Hollow Knight.
Yeah, I was going to mention Hollow Knight, yeah.
Hollow Knight feels like Symphony of the Night. And I don't think it's an accident. It is a fantastic looking, feeling, playing game. I'm very early into it, but man, that is a good game. Do not miss that this year. And I think you could speak to Dead Cells a little bit better than I could, Robert.
Yo, Dead Cells is that Metroidvania game you've never known you always wanted. It's a roguelike, but in such a great Metroidvania style that I think fits it very well. And it's done in a way where mechanics in Metroidvanias don't get in the way of the mechanics of roguelike games, which makes it it's so fun to run around and, like, get used to your 2D combat, figure out what weapons you like best and find those weapons hidden in walls or, like, you know, like wall chickens. Basically, this game has that too.
Wall chickens.
Yeah. I mean, instead of chicken, it's like other foods, I think, but it's such a great, it's a good way to, like, if you love speed running or time trialing, like Symphony of the Night, this is a game for you. Absolutely. It's all about efficiency and, like, getting getting good and, you know, figuring out the best way to kill each enemy, knowing when to dodge roll at the right time, knowing when to swing what weapon, and all that kind of stuff.
So kind of like Rogue Legacy?
Yeah, yeah, but I think way
more. They're going to say Rogue Lettuce.
I know.
Rogue
Lettuce.
Rogue Lettuce. It's a lot like Rogue Lettuce.
Rogue Lettuce.
No, it's a, I think the combat is way more exciting in Dead Cells.
Okay.
I think so.
Cool. Cool, but, man. I mean, you know, the moral of the story, right, is like, what a hell of a year for video games, and what a hell of a brunch this was. I'm full.
Yeah. Check. Wait. Check, please. Thank you.
Yeah, we need three separate ones because I'm not
buying
them.
Oh, yeah.
Wait, Jack's not paying.
One more little. Oh, shit. One more little morsel, though, to come with the check as we get it. So it's kind of cheating, but I still haven't played The Last Guardian yet, and I really want to. I know it came out in December of last year.
Oh,
I know it's December of last year.
That game with that giant dog, cat,
dog,
flying
bird, cat
thing.
Yeah, no.
I heard it was just okay.
I mean, I don't care. It's a Team Ico game, so I want it in my life. And they just announced they're doing a VR demo or like a VR thing for it.
Whoa. Like the game or just like a one-off kind of?
It's just a one-off demo little thing, which is disappointing, but it's still cool. It's free.
Watch it be a fishing game, like the VR Final Fantasy fishing game.
Yep, that's exciting. I think we should probably wrap up, though, for our first episode here. You've got 9 more coming, so, you know, get excited. Keep your headphones ready. Get ready to download
Please
more episodes.
Be excited.
Hell
Please
of
be
a year.
Excited. Yes.
Hell of a year, guys. These are all the games we wish we played, couldn't play, just didn't have the time. But, man, we're going to get into the meat of the games we actually did delve into in the coming days. And we'll see you on the other side.
Yes. So tomorrow, expect us to talk about games, whether like which games looked the best. We can explain tomorrow. See you on the other side. This has been the Tiniest Podcast.
Merry Christmas.
And happy holidays.
Does your soul still burn?
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Everywhere you go.
Take a look in the 5 and 10.
Glistening once again.
With candy canes and silver lanes aglow.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Toys in every store.
But the prettiest sight to see is the holly that will be on your own front door. A pair of hop-along boots and a pistol that chooses the wish of Barney.